Axios is reporting that there is complete turmoil within the Biden administration over the ongoing migrant crisis. Now, their report begins with a previously undisclosed meeting that took place among Biden administration officials aboard Air Force One, as he and his team were headed to the southern border. As Axios writes, the president lit into his team, which included then Deputy Chief of Staff Jen O'Malley, Dillon, Homeland Security advisor Liz Sherwood-Randall, and other immigration officials. He demanded obscure immigration data points and vented when his staff didn't have them handy. The previously unreported meeting was recounted to Axios by three separate people familiar with the events and how they went down that day. People in the meeting later told others in frustration that his, meaning Biden's, winding process and irritability were making it more difficult to reach decisions about the border, meaning they're throwing him under the bus. As the humanitarian conditions at the border have deteriorated and the politics surrounding immigration have become a thorn for Biden, he becomes scratchier when the issue comes up, according to current and former aides. And you can understand why he's become scratchier as the issue comes up, because he is losing quite a bit of support, even among Democratic voters, in how he has handled the migrant crisis. And that has a lot to do with the fact that migrants have been sent to a lot of these big blue cities like Chicago, places in Colorado, also in New York City. You know, these are strongholds for Democratic voters, and they're not liking what they're seeing, and they want more help from the Biden administration, more action from the Biden administration. The White House is also in a bit of denial here. The White House counters that the meeting was productive. Spokesperson Andrew Bates told Axios that multiple firsthand participants of the meeting refute this description of the tone of and outcome of a conversation on the specifics of this complex issue. I don't believe that at all. Okay, so I wouldn't take that at face value. But there's so much more to get into in regard to Axios reporting on this, because there's been some backstabbing, some infighting. You have Susan Rice and Kamala Harris apparently fighting behind the scenes over the immigration issue. The White House's immigration team saw constant turnover. As a result, the strategy was incoherent from the very beginning, said one former Biden White House official involved in immigration policy. Publicly, the White House also initially downplayed jumps in illegal border crossings as normal ebbs and flows, even as some internally pushed to acknowledge that the problem was significant. So we're gonna get to the infighting and all of that in just a moment, but Cenk, I wanted to give you an opportunity to jump in on this problem that apparently was brewing for quite some time, and the Biden administration just kind of didn't do much about it.
Yeah, the first thing that I'm always amazed by, it's not the first time obviously, is how little they care about getting things done. So a lot of the people in the administration didn't want to own this problem. And as soon as I read that, I thought, oh, okay, I totally get it. That happens inside companies, where if something's difficult, nobody wants to be in charge of it or responsible for it, because they're afraid that it's gonna look bad for them if they can't get it done, and it's already super hard, right? By the way, number one, that shows you that you have a bad boss. Because a boss should know, I am assigning an easy task, a medium task, or a difficult task. And if I'm assigning a difficult task and they don't get it done right away, I know it's because I assigned a difficult task. But apparently Biden's a moron and doesn't know that. And so he's like, I don't know, and so they all try to avoid it. Second of all, Biden was avoiding it for almost his entire term. See, that's the part I'm most amazed by.
Yeah.
Because if I was president, I would feel enormous responsibility to solve all of the issues. Now you're gonna solve them all at once. You're not gonna solve it overnight, and you can't do everything at the same time. But a giant issue like immigration, even if it was a tiny issue, I'd be like, is someone on it? Who's on it? How are we solving it? What's the timeline, right? But one of the largest issues in your administration, and you just kind of like, it seems like a pain in the ass. Are you kidding me? And this is how the most powerful people on earth make decisions. Then he assigns it to Kamala Harris, which is a way of screwing her over, because he knows how hard it is, yep, and she won't be able to do anything besides when she's incompetent. So she goes and focuses on the Northern Triangle, that's three countries, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras. And she says, that's my only remit. Now, if I'm the vice president and somebody and the president gives me that job, what do I want to do? I want to do the best that I can, and I don't want to say, hey, limit my role. You're the vice president already, you almost do nothing. I would want to expand my role, even though it's difficult. And I would come up with endless ideas until I was a pain in his ass. I'd be like, here's plan A, plan B, plan C, plan D. Which one do you think we should do, President Biden? I'm not overstepping. Mm-hmm. I'm just giving him tons of options. Hey, Kamala Harris, did you ever give him any options?
I know, but
Jesus, man. But what are they doing? We might have millions of people watching this show, but you can be the difference maker, because we just need 1% of our audience to be paid members, and then this show can be around forever. So you can make that difference. Click join now.
Kamala Harris is not suited for this role. And Kamala Harris was a prosecutor, a career prosecutor in California. And then she was somehow miraculously elected into the Senate. I only say miraculously because have you heard her speak publicly? Like, how the hell did she get elected into the United States Senate?
I'll tell you how. Okay. Money.
All right. So, like, part of me feels some sympathy for her because she's not an expert on immigration policy. And to simply say, like, Kamala, you deal with immigration policy and then blame her for being ineffective, it's just. It's unfair to her. It is. It is unfair to her.
No. He set her up to fail because
he did.
He's caught feelings from the campaign. And then why did you pick her to be vice president? Jesus Christ. But all that notwithstanding, Anna, you're right about that. But and if you were the vice president and somebody gave you that job, you wouldn't go, oh, I'm not prepared for this. I don't know how to. You would research.
I would endlessly research. That is true.
You would come up with a plan. You would ask for permission to execute that plan. But the people in charge, we keep making the mistake of thinking they have good intent and they think like we do. No, they're just in the ass protection business, okay?
They
just want to protect their own ass. It's all about their own ego. That's why they hide. And I want you to notice too, one more thing before we go back to the details. Notice how Biden is irritable, and they keep, this is like the 18th story in a row where he's irritable.
Because he's 81 years old.
Exactly. That's what happens when you're 81 and you're beginning to have dementia. You can't remember things and you get really irritable. We're all supposed to pretend it's not happening even though we could all see it.
Okay, now just real quick in regard to Kamala Harris. Look, the thing that I can't stand about this is like the backstabbing and then the leaking to the press where you're just like bad mouthing the people you're supposed to be collaborating with and working with in order to find solutions. But one person, a former Biden administration senior official who spoke to Axios says, of Kamala Harris. She's been at best ineffective and at worst sporadically engaged, and not seeing it was her responsibility. It's an opportunity for her and she didn't fill the breach, this person said. Now, real quick, before we go to more of the infighting, including one Biden administration official accusing another administration official of being a bitch ass. We're gonna get to that in just a moment. I do wanna just give you a refresher on how Biden differed from Trump in terms of immigration policy. Because there are executive orders that the president can put out. And there were some deals that Trump made that apparently were unwound by Biden. I was unfamiliar with that, or the reporting just wasn't clear on that. So it was like, oh, well, Biden's not doing what Trump did. Okay, well, what did Trump do that Biden isn't doing? And now we finally have the answer. So I want to give that to you. So for instance, if you look at Title 42, as we know, Title 42 banned asylum seekers from entering the country, citing the coronavirus pandemic as an emergency that would prevent them from coming in. Title 42 is over. COVID is over, so you can't use Title 42 anymore. So that was one area where Biden didn't have the same excuse that Trump did. But let's keep going. Biden ended Trump's remain in Mexico policy. That was the first thing he did, one of the first things he did when he became president. So the remain in Mexico policy basically allowed for asylum seekers to remain in Mexico as their asylum claims were being adjudicated, rather than allowing them into the country and just kind of releasing them into the country for several years until an immigration judge can hear their case. When he undid that, that ended up leading to a massive influx of asylum seekers coming into the country. At that point, Biden was like, oh no, I want to re-implement the Remain in Mexico plan. But at that point, the president of Mexico is like, nah, dog, I'm not into it anymore. We're not going to do this. So he kind of hurt himself by undoing the Remain in Mexico plan. There were other things as well. For instance, the administration extended temporary protections for Venezuelans in the United States and weeks later announced plans to deport Venezuelans for the first time in years.
Oops.
So he keeps doing these things, I guess, to appeal to the progressive base. And then he realizes, oh no, this is actually leading to a massive influx of migrants into the country, and he tries to reverse it. But oftentimes there are obstacles in the way of him being able to do that. Biden's team also stopped holding undocumented families in the US detention centers, a practice under Presidents Bush, Obama, and Trump in favor of instead monitoring people with ankle bracelets. Then as conditions worsened, Biden considered reinstating the detention program. Just, he's a mess all around, guys. He really is. Okay, now let's get back to some of the other infighting. So Suzanne Rice used to be a domestic policy advisor within the Biden administration, and apparently she really took charge when it came to immigration policy. And some officials found that she was needlessly combative and they disagreed with her policy-wise. But even many of her critics credit her for actually wanting to take initiative on the migrant crisis. But then she got into some issues with Javier Becerra, who is the Secretary for Health and Human Services. There was and still is deep animosity toward Health and Human Services Secretary Javier Becerra for what was seen as his reluctance to find more space in child migrant shelters, which are overseen by HHS, according to several sources familiar with the dynamics. Suzanne Rice referred to Becerra as a bitch ass and privately called him an idiot, according to multiple sources, because of his reluctance in finding the migrant shelters.
Yeah, but I don't know who's right, Rice or Becerra.
Me either. I mean, I kind of enjoy colorful language, so I'm not gonna use that as a mark against her, but yeah, I don't know who's right or wrong.
Yeah, it 100% depends. She might be bullying him and totally in the wrong and taking out her frustrations on and trying to blame someone else, or he might be an idiot and have totally not done his job. I have no idea, but here's what I'm not that moved by. This as an attack against Susan Rice. Well, it depends. So if you're saying, oh, can you believe she used bad language against another Biden administration official? Yeah, I don't care at all.
How about this? During one meeting when Biden was tearing into Becerra, Rice passed Alejandro Mayorkas a note that read, don't save him, according to two people familiar with the meeting.
Yeah. Look, and then Susan Rice had issues because she was probably runner up to the in the VP spot. And so I wouldn't be surprised if she's undercutting Kamala Harris. For a long time in the beginning of the administration, there was talk of Kamala Harris and Pete Buttigieg undercutting one another because they thought they were gonna compete for the presidency either in 24 or 28.
Power, precious.
Exactly.
Like, it's all about power. Yeah. It's all about personal enrichment. It's amazing.
Well, that's the thing, right? So we look at it as solving the issues, and we want them to solve the issue. What's the best way to do it? Is it 42? Is it not? Is it stay in place? Is it not? I think it's a Marshall Plan. You can't say, hey, let's do sanctions on Venezuela and then be surprised that tons of Venezuelans are coming here in desperation, right? You should cut it off at the source, but they won't do that because, oh, the politics of it won't work out well, etc., etc. But guys, the number one thing to take away from this is they're not actually trying to solve the problem. They're just trying to figure out which couch to stuff it under so that it'll look like they're trying to solve the problem. And that's the Biden administration in a nutshell. And then when things go wrong, they go him, her, then they blame each other and they're all useless. Why don't one of you come up with a plan and then sell that plan to Biden so we can execute it? Oh my God, I don't wanna own it. I don't wanna own it. Well, then why'd you get into government? I know why, ego.
And power, yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks for watching. If you become a member, you get to watch all this ad-free, except for, of course, this ad. Still, hit the join button below.